Father, we just pray that this time around your word will be precious to us. Lord, we thank you that these words are indeed holy scripture. And Father, we pray that by the power of your spirit, you would interpret to our hearts and minds and speak to our souls as we are in your presence this night. Pray that the words of my lips and the meditation of our hearts will be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. In Jesus' name. Now, today, we've had one message in two parts, and we've been looking at Paul's first prayer in Ephesians chapter 1. So we're going to read it again tonight. We covered his petition in the prayer this morning in verse 17. And we called our message this morning, the privilege of the Christian. And I announced to you this morning that tonight we will be dealing with the promise of the Christian. So we're going to read Paul's prayer again. It's in Ephesians chapter 1. And we'll commence to read at verse 15. Ephesians chapter 1. Therefore, I also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ and your love for all the saints, do not cease to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give to you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling, what are the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power toward us who believe, according to the working of his mighty power, which he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places, far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in that which is to come. And he put all things under his feet and gave him to be head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. Now, tonight, our text is really based around verses 18 and 19. The eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling, what are the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power toward us who believe, according to the working of his mighty power, which he worked in Christ. Leave it there. Now, tonight, as I say, this morning, the privilege of the Christian, tonight, the promise of the Christian. I think the screen is wrong. Praise the Lord. That's better. So tonight, the promise of the Christian. Now, the overall title, really, given to this prayer, as I said this morning, was the culmination of it in verse 23, where Paul is speaking of the fullness of him, the fullness of Christ. And in this prayer, it strongly emphasized the fullness of Christ. And in Paul's second prayer in chapter 3 of Ephesians, it's the fullness of God. So when Paul was writing to these Ephesian Christians and to us all, he has got high hopes. He's got great expectations that we should just not sit still after having known the truth, that truth that is in chapter 1 and verse 7, that in him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. But his hopes for us are very high indeed. In fact, having known the truth, he's wanting us all to aim higher, to move on in God. Now, in verse 17, we dealt with this morning, he said that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give to you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him. Now, the aim is the fullness of Christ, and also that every one of us may have that spiritual reality. And I'm sure that every one of us here tonight want to be God to be so real to us in our lives. You know, you might say, well, I know the doctrine, I know the scriptures, I know how I should submit to God, but I want him to be real, that my heart might burn within me at the very thought of the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's what Paul is praying for very much in this passage. And he helps us by going through stages in this prayer. Now, he's asked this morning that we might have the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him. Wisdom to comprehend, knowledge to embrace this great revelation of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, that we might know him in an intimate way. Now, tonight, as I said, we come to the promise for the Christian in verses 18 and 19. And he begins first by saying, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened. Friends, before we were saved, we were in darkness. We were in the black. We were in complete and utter darkness. But when God saved us, the eyes of our spiritual understanding were enlightened. But remember, you've got to also remember that Paul is speaking to Christians here. And he says, if you take careful note of the scripture, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened. So, yes, you could take the verse that way, that we've been enlightened when we got saved, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened. But Paul prays, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened. So on the other hand, we could say that in his prayer, he's praying that their eyes of understanding will continue to be enlightened. And I want you to notice that he prays for three things here. The first reality is at the beginning of the Christian life, that you may know what is the hope of his calling. The second reality is at the end of the Christian life, the riches of the glory of his inheritance. And the third reality is what lies between the beginning and the end of the Christian life. What is the exceeding greatness of the power toward us who believe? Now, I want us to look at these three things this evening. First of all, what is at the beginning of the Christian life? And I highlight those words in verse 18, that you may know what is the hope of his calling. The reference, if you like, is to an effectual calling. That is the way in which God brings us to Christ initially, the work of God's power, the work of God's grace, where he draws us to Christ by the word and by the Spirit, saving us, changing us from darkness to light. But I want you to notice the hope of his calling. It's the work of God that brings us to Christ. You see, even though the gospel is preached, it is only the work of God that brings us to Jesus Christ. It says in the second book of Timothy, in chapter 1 and in verse 9, who has saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, which has been given to us in Christ Jesus before time began. I want you to also notice about this calling, it takes place according to God's purpose. Because we read in Romans chapter 8 and verse 28, we know that all things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose. I want you to also notice, thirdly, it's a work of grace. Paul writes in Galatians chapter 1 and verses 15 and 16, but when it pleased God, who separated me from my mother's womb and called me through his grace to reveal his son in me, that I might preach him among the Gentiles, I did not immediately confer with flesh and blood. But when it pleased God, who separated me from my mother's womb and called me through his grace to reveal his son in me. It was a work of grace. You see, friends, I didn't deserve to be saved. I was an unwinnable, obstinate, lost sinner. The call of God on my life was pure grace. Fourthly, let me say about this calling, the Spirit accompanies the gospel, and it's through the Spirit that we are called. Ephesians 4, there is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called in one hope of your calling. So, friends, our conversion, you see, was brought about not only by the word of God, but by the power of the Holy Spirit. And that happens when the gospel is preached, not in word only, but in demonstration of the Spirit and with power. Then I want to say about this calling, it is efficacious and it's irresistible. You see, the gospel may be despised and rejected by most of us at one time in our lives. But when the Holy Spirit called us, he called us. Hallelujah. And when the Holy Spirit calls a person, called he is from death unto life. John chapter 5 and verse 25. And when most assuredly I say to you, the hour is coming and now is, when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear will live. Hallelujah. Friends, I want to say this calling, it's God that brings it about. And then, of course, about this calling, we are brought into Jesus Christ. 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and verse 9 tells us this. God is faithful, by whom you were called into the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And then let me say, seventhly, that as a result of this calling, we have ground for hope. And this verse in Ephesians 1:18 speaks of the hope of his calling. Friends, we have grounds for hope tonight. God loves us. Hallelujah. Christ died for us. The Holy Spirit is working in us. God will preserve us. And ultimately, he will have us in heaven at last because we are called. Now, Paul prays that we might know what is the hope of his calling. And he's praying it because he wants us to know that hope of his calling in a way that affects our hearts and our lives. That you might know, he says. You see, it's one thing to ascend to it, but it's another to experientially to be aware of it. So what impression should this make upon us? Well, God has called us. And so, friends, I want to encourage you to fix your eyes upon Jesus, that we might be closer to him. Because if God has called us to himself, then to know that calling in experience is surely to be kept close with God himself. This dry air. We've been called from sin. So surely we should remember that it was from a dunghill God called us. Therefore, it should make us want to, as we've been dealing on Wednesday nights, put to death our members which are on the earth, no longer living our lives in the lusts of our flesh or in the social sins, as we read of last Wednesday night in Colossians 3. But this calling is of grace, friends, and to know the power of his calling to glory by the grace of God, not of works, but his amazing grace. God called us by his gospel, and therefore this calling makes us love and appreciate the gospel. God called us. Colossians chapter 2, verse 13, but now in Christ Jesus, you who once were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has made both one and has broken down the middle wall of separation. Therefore, as Paul writes in Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 1, I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you to walk worthy of the calling with which you were called. Well, the hope of his calling. And Paul says here, when he's praying for these people, that you might know the hope of his calling. Surely this should make us hate the things of the world, friends, and keep our hearts and our eyes fixed on Jesus Christ. Secondly, what is at the end of the Christian life? Well, look at verse 18 again. That you might know what are the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints. Now, that reference is twofold. Because, first of all, it's a reference to the inheritance with which one day we shall possess. It's mentioned theologians, they're quite varied on this, but generally, most theologians think it's a reference to the inheritance which we shall one day possess. Others think it refers to something else. I agree with all the commentators because I think there's an element of truth in both meanings here. But first, it's a reference to the inheritance which we shall one day possess. It's mentioned in verse 11. In him also we have obtained an inheritance. And again in verse 14, who is the guarantee of our inheritance. And so Paul says in verse 18, the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints. That word can also mean among the saints in the Greek. And Paul said to the Ephesians in Acts chapter 20 and in verse 22, he said these words. And see now, I go bound in the spirit to Jerusalem, not knowing what will happen to me there, except that the Holy... verse 32. So now, brethren, I commend to you God and to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and give you an inheritance among all those who are sanctified. So that word there... can be used among in the Greek as well as what it can in the when it says the riches of his glory of his inheritance in the saints. So first, it's a reference to the inheritance that one day we shall possess. This kingdom of heaven, glorious kingdom of heaven, the glory of his inheritance. And every blessing is laid up for us there, isn't it, friends? With an absolute abundance of benefit. But secondly, on that one, one might say it can also be a reference to what Christ has done for us. That you might know what are the riches of his inheritance in the saints. Friends, what a price he paid. What a sacrifice he inherited in the saints, one might say. Friends, when you think about it, heaven came down for glory to fill my soul. So you see, both these things are true in that statement. But to have these things before us and to aspire to them and to long for them. Heaven has been prepared for us, and therefore we must live in each day in anticipation of that inheritance, cultivating holiness in our lives. You know, just as Moses despised the riches of Egypt for the riches of Christ. Friends, let's not deflect in our lives to the temptation of the world, but be people of vision, people of one goal, glory. Oh, I know we have a lot to put up with in this life, don't we? Sufferings, trials, circumstances, sicknesses. But friends, keep your eyes on Jesus, because we know the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints. Bear your cross, knowing that one day you'll wear a crown. If we suffer with him, the Bible says, then we shall reign with him. The hymn writer said, and we've been hearing it, strangely enough, tonight. I'd forgotten we were going to be hearing that. Whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to know, it is well. It is well with my soul. Glory to God, friends. We shall triumph. Oh, I want to dance over the top of this pulpit. I might lose my job. I don't think so. But thirdly tonight, let's have a look. We've looked at what the beginning of the Christian life, the end of the Christian life. Let's look at what lies in between the beginning and the end. back to Ephesians and to chapter 1. I'll read from verse 18 again. The eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling, what are the riches of the glories of inheritance in the saints, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power toward us who believe according to his mighty power. Glory to God. What Paul means is this. That the whole energy of the divine being is being made to bear on us. He uses this expression, the exceeding greatness. In other words, the surpassing greatness of our God. And he says, if you want to know the greatness of this power, it's the very same power, he says later in the chapter, that raised Jesus Christ from the dead. Look what he says, and I'm going to read these verses. And what is the exceeding greatness of his power toward us who believe, according to the working of his mighty power, which he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places, far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in that which is to come. And he put all things under his feet and gave him to be head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. Oh, friends, the church filled with the blessing and the glory of God. So you see what it is that from the beginning, from our calling to the end of our calling, our inheritance here is available to us. And we have the power working in us of the mighty God. The power to be preserved in life. Friends, all that you might know it, all that you might know it to overcome temptation, all that you know might know it, that even if you sin, you will not despair, because the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, and he delighteth in his way. And though he fall, he shall not be utterly cast down. Why? Because the Lord upholds him with his hand. Know it in the sense, friends, that you will be preserved in your Christian life. Know it, that even as you feel your quickening desires for heaven, know it, even as you die in faith and assurance, the exceeding greatness of his power even in that. Know it as we await the return of our King, because he who has called you will uphold you. We are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation. Now, in conclusion, maybe there are those here today, and as you've got older, your burdens have become greater. Maybe you're suffering perhaps from ill health. Maybe your mind is somewhat fatigued. Maybe sometimes your mind begins to fail you and days of darkness come over your soul. But friends, low as you may be, you will not fall out of the hands of God. The exceeding greatness of his power. Whatever difficulties you encounter, you will not fail so as to be utterly ashamed. Even in death, you will prove the exceeding greatness of his power. Oh, that, friends, we might know these things, not just up there, but in here, so that they're a part of our being. That like the bee, you won't just land on a flower, but you'll extract the pollen. So to sum up today's ministry, let me, well, I've just got to read it again. I can't stop reading this. I was reading it when I went to bed last night. I was reading it when I got up this morning. I was reading it before the meeting this morning. I was reading it after the meeting. I read it this afternoon. I read it before I came down tonight. Paul said, therefore, I also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ and your love for all the saints, do not cease to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give to you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling, what are the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power toward us who believe, according to the working of his mighty power which he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead, seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places, far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, and only not only in this age but also in that which is to come. And he put all things under his feet and gave him to be head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. What a Savior. What we're going to sing, standing on the promises of Christ my King. Through eternal ages, let his praises ring. Glory in the highest. I will shout and sing, standing on the promises of God. Friends, let's stop sitting on the premises and stand on the promises. Glory to God. Come on, Julia.